good enough. You guys don't make me feel very welcome today. Good morning, New Life.
Good morning.
Could we stand, please, as we read the Word of God? Jesus has been preaching to a body of believers and a body of hypocrites. Welcome to New Life, amen. Let me just read what he said. Luke chapter 12 and verse 1. In the meantime, when so many thousands of people had gathered together that they were trampling one another, he began to say to his disciples, first, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. Nothing is covered up that will not be revealed, or hidden that will not be known. Therefore, what you have said in the dark shall be heard in the light, and what you have whispered in the private room shall be proclaimed in the housetops. And this is Jesus speaking to this group of people. And he says, I tell you, my friends, do not fear those who kill the body and after have nothing more they can do. But I will warn you, to whom you shall fear. Fear him who, after he is killed, has authority to cast into hell. Yes, I tell you, fear him. Are not five sparrows sold for 2 pennies, and not one of them forgotten before God? Even the very hairs on your head are all numbered. Fear not, you are of more value than many sparrows. You are of more value than many sparrows. Let me say that again. You are of more value than many sparrows. So we're going to start with beware the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. But you're of great value this morning. Amen. Can we open up in prayer? Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, I just want to thank you for those who have assembled together today. Father, some of them have been with us for a long time. Some of this are brand new to us, Lord God. We just pray that we are all encouraged to hear from you today. As we worship you today, Lord God, my prayer is that our hearts are not held back from our love and our expression of that love in the way that we worship. I also pray, Lord God, when we prepared to hear the word, Lord God, that we truly open our hearts up to hear the truth of what the Holy Spirit wants to say to us today. Because I believe he wants to speak something loudly and clearly to this congregation of believers to make them better. We love you so, Father, in Jesus we pray. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Let's worship.
There's a light that burns in the darkness. There is a hope that washes the fear away. There is a peace that settles around us. It is your love that sets our hearts ablaze. There is a light that burns in the darkness. There is a fear that crashes the fear away. There is a peace that settles around us. It is your love that sets our hearts ablaze. Father, we're on our knees, with every heartbeat we bring you this offering. Lord, come and fill this place. Father, we're crying out, Spirit, we need you now. Glorious love surrounds us. Lord, come and fill this place. There is a king that reigns in victory. There is a mercy strong enough to save. We feel it rising up from the ashes. There is a love that overcame the grave. There is a love that overcame the grave. Father, we're on our knees, with every heartbeat we bring you this offering. Lord, come and fill this place. Father, we're crying out, Spirit, we need you now. will worship you. I worship you. I worship you always. Come on, lift your voices. And I will worship you. I worship you. I worship you always. And I will worship you. I worship you. I worship you always. And I will worship you. I worship you. I worship you always. And I will worship you. I worship you. I worship you always. And I will worship you. I worship you. I worship you always. Father, we're on our knees with every heart beating. Bring you this offering. Lord, come and fill this place. Father, we're crying out. Spirit, we need you now. Glorious life surround. Lord, we'll worship you. How and I will I sing praises to your name. Praise. higher than all names. All honor to your name. Honor to your name. The name that's so much greater than all names. Be lifted up. Be lifted higher. Be lifted up. Be lifted higher. Come on, praise. I sing praises to your name. Praises to your name. So much higher than all names. All honor to your name. All honor to your name. The name that's so much greater.
A love that always binds me. on your knee.
Your name is life. Your name is hope inside me. Hope inside me. Your name is love. A love that always finds me. Always finds me.
Your name is.
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true.
'Cause I am found. I am yours.
My heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true.
'Cause you are strong, you are sure, you are life.
Here's my heart, Lord.
speak what is true.
Here's my life.
Here's my life, Lord.
Song really resonates as far as like my prayer. Some of the questions were easy for me, and then some of them really kind of shook me up, and that was kind of my prayer. It's like, Lord, here's my heart, here's my life. Speak truth, speak into my heart what things need to be shown to light, Father, because that's what rooted is all about, is becoming rooted in Him and in His love. But we can't become rooted if we're not laying our hearts and our life out for Him to grasp. We can't. We have to have that transparency for Him to work in us. And sometimes that's scary, and sometimes that means going places we don't want to go, not even with God. And now we're put in this group, and I'm just so excited to go alongside with people as each of us get to that place of vulnerability with Him, where we truly say, I'm taking that step, and I'm tired of playing Christian, and I'm tired of just going to church, but here's my life. Truly, here's my life, and here's my heart. And Father, I'm opening it up for you to speak truth, because that's what it's about. And then the relationship with him can grow and become rooted. And it's such a beautiful, beautiful thing to experience. So I love that song and what it speaks, because it's so true. And I love it because that's what we're going with as a church and as people and individuals, as we each grow our relationship with Christ. And it's exciting. Yeah.
I think our prayer would be that you would be poured out. As Paul says in the letters, that my prayer is that you would be poured out on all flesh. God may see his divine work in you. So we're going to sing that chorus one more time. I'm going to ask you to do something. I'm going to ask you to put your hands just as like a cup under your heart. Just asking God, give him permission to say, do a work here, God. Do what only you can do. Come in. Come on, we can't do this life. We can't do the Christian life on our own. You guys have tried it. That's why you're here this morning, because you can't do it. We're not a bunch of holy people here. We're only holy by his grace. We're messed up. We're all messed up here. That's why we're here. We finally said, man, I can't do it. Come on.
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Yes, here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. Here's my life. Yes, here's my life, Lord. Yes, here's my life, Lord. Here's my life, Lord. Speak what is true. Speak what is true. Speak what is
praise be your welcome. Let our song be a sign. We are here for you. We are here for you. Let your breath come from heaven. Fill our hearts with your light. We are here for you. We are here for you. To you our hearts are open, nothing here is hidden. You are our one desire. You alone are holy, only worthy God. It's your fire fall down. Let our shout be your anthem, your renown and fill the sky. We are here for you. We are here for you. Let your word be power and come alive. We are here for you. Oh, we are here for you. To you are our on fire for tonight.
To you I'm on.
To you I'm hearts are open. Nothing here is hidden. You are our one desire. Fire fall down. Let your fire fall down. Lord, we welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. This place, let every heart adore, let every soul away. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. God of love, be welcomed in this place. Be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be you.
Let every heart, let every yard adore, let every soul awake. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcome. Come on, we welcome. Be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcome in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love,
be welcome. Every heart.
Let every heart adore, let every soul away. Almighty God of love,
be welcomed in this place.
We welcome you with praise.
We welcome you with praise.
Almighty God of love.
Time to worship you. Lord, thank you so much for your abundant support of us during our struggles, during our celebrations. And Lord, I just ask that you accept these tithes and offerings as our practice and faith towards you. You are our Father. We love you. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Your hearts are open. Nothing here is hidden. You are our one desire. You alone are holy. Only you are worthy. God, let your fire fall down through you. To you our hearts are open. Nothing here is hidden. You are our one desire. You alone are holy, only you are worthy, God, let your fire fall down, let your fire. Well.
on, one second. We're not done yet. Mikey Brim is one of our Fight Club leaders, and he went through our initial Fight Club group. We really saw God do a great work in him, and so he wants to share something from his heart. Amen. And I want you to be encouraged by it. So, Mikey, share with us.
So, this week we've taken a single verse of Proverbs and meditated on it. Took what God gave us from it and shared it. So, the verse is Proverbs 12, verse 3. No one is established by wickedness, but the root of the righteous will never be moved. This brought up a lot of things for me. I've heard it said that you don't get to keep money that you steal. I lived a wicked life for a time. I sold drugs, was a thief. I just floated through life feeding my addiction, avoiding responsibility. I lived that way until I had nothing. After coming back to the Lord, he has established my life and set me back on solid ground. For that, I'm so very grateful. But for me right now, as I'm building a life for my family, it's important to remember that God's will for my life is less about my comfort and more about my contribution. I don't want to get too focused on receiving blessing upon blessing. Sure, God gave me life back. That's what he does. I'm grateful. But today, I want to think about pushing myself forward into new ground he's leading me to.
Amen. Father, I want to thank you for young men who are not just developing a relationship with you, but understanding your word and understanding how it applies and are willing to share it with the world, Lord God, that needs to know that there's a God in heaven that can take somebody who used to do and sell drugs and change their life and give them blessing over blessing over blessing over blessing, but still recognizing it's not, that's not the focus. The focus is the peace of Christ that he's received. So encourage our hearts today, Lord God, as we hear from you. We love you, in Jesus we pray. And all God's people loudly said,
amen.
You may be seated. You may be seated. Thank you, Michael and Joey. Joey's our other Fight Club leader. And I have been out of the pulpit for 3 weeks, so I'm just going to warn you, I'm rusty. Meaning that this could come across really harsh are really helpful. And I'm just warning you now, you can take it as you want. But I believe that this is something that God has been speaking to me about for a while. And I believe he wants me to share it with you. I would like you to pray, continue to pray for Susan Vaughn and her cancer. We're going to pray, hopefully somebody remind me at the end of the service, don't let me forget, to pray for Susan. We also want to pray for our teachers. We're to one service now, so they don't get a service unless it's online and when we give them a Sabbath. So please be praying for our teachers who are taking care of your children. They love them, and they're making quite a sacrifice for you that you may be able to hear the word of God clearly without your kids screaming in your ear. I'm normally much louder than this, but I still don't have lung capacity yet. So if I grow into a coughing fit, somebody please lay hands on me and heal me. And well, Pastor Mark's right there. We'll have him. Thank you for coming today. I missed being in the pulpit. I love what God has called me to do. And if you want to turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 12, we are back in our iDisciple series. I don't know how long. Give me a break, man. There's so much out of the Word of God I feel like God wants to speak to this congregation about. I do want to thank those of you that have been involved in Rooted so far. This was our first week, and I hope it's been an encouragement to you. My group has not met yet. My group is meeting at 5 o'clock in the morning on Thursdays in Napa, when real men meet. And I'm sure there'll be some spotlighting deer on the way. But I'm really excited to meet with those guys out there. And, wow. Can I just pray for a bit? Father, there are people in this room that still do not understand you. And they heard all these songs that we sang about you, and they heard our passion, watched my wife beat me up with her worship. And they don't know you. They don't understand you. So my prayer for them today is that they would hear something from your spirit that would totally change everything they knew about you. But Father, there's also people that think they know you that don't. And I don't know why that's been so heavy on my heart in the last few months, but I constantly, Father, think about that passage of Scripture that is in your word that states that there's going to be so many that are going to get up there and say, Lord, Lord, have we not done all these wonderful things? And you said, depart from me, you that work iniquity. I never even knew you. Meaning they didn't even know you. And Father, in this room, there are some faithful, godly people. Lovers of yours. Livers of everything that you command. And I get to do life with them, and I'm so grateful for them. But today is about one thing, clarification. So as we sang the song about hearing from you, and I pray that they really, their hearts are really offered up to you today. I love these people. I love this place. I love this church. I love this community. I love Christianity. I love life. All because of what you've done for me, through me and to me. And I want everyone to have that. In Jesus we pray. Amen. When Jesus' ministry began, the crowds were curious, convicted, and changed. It's like Jesus began to speak, and all these people were like really interested in what he had to say. And that reminds me of a lot of people that I run into. Like when they first hear about the gospel of Jesus Christ, that he forgives sins, that he loves them, that he cares for them, they're just all excited, and they want to hear more, and they want to know more, and they change things. There's things that they used to do that now they don't do because they know the word says don't do that, so they don't do. They don't even argue about it. They don't even try to figure it out. They just say, okay, God said do this, that's what I'm going to do. That's when Jesus' ministry began. But where we're reading now is in a place where the majority of the people we're following were actually more resistant to the preaching of Jesus Christ. They had stopped being so interested, and they began to kind of push back a little bit. Actually push back a lot. There were actually more in this crowd who were opposed to the truth, who were concerned about how they looked more than how they lived. How they were perceived by man, not how they were perceived by God. They had a form of godliness, but they denied the power thereof. In fact, his crowds were large, but he viewed them mostly as liars. They were all claiming this belief in God, but they weren't living it in the way that he laid it out. People followed him, but it was to be filled with physical things, and they followed him because they were fascinated by the miraculous. They weren't following him by faith because they believed he was the Son of the living God. They followed him because they wanted to receive something from him. Leading Jesus to be confronted with the faithlessness of these people who he was trying to encourage to believe in him. So Jesus, in front of all of these people, says, beware the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. And then he begins to speak on this subject of hypocrisy. In fact, Jesus spent much of his 3 years on this planet in his ministry dealing with disciples who were influenced by the permeating negativity of religious people. It was the religious people who Jesus continued to fight against. Instead of having a whole bunch of people who were just soaking up the word of God and trusting and living by faith, there was a bunch of people who were constantly acting like they were spiritual but were not. And if you studied your Bible, if you studied the gospel, you would see Jesus constantly talking and attacking hypocrites. Because Jesus believed that hypocrites were fake believers. They pretended to be something they were not, focused more on the outward look of faith to hide the truth of who they really were. Jesus in Mark said this, in Mark chapter 7, verse 6, he said, "Well did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites, as it is written, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me.'" It's like they say all the right spiritual things, but their heart is not really given to God. They can play the game spiritually and make it look really good, but their heart is far from him. And if you look at Matthew chapter 6, and so this is for people who write notes. If you look at Matthew chapter 6, I'm not going to give you all the verses. You're just going to have to look them up on your own. And that's sometimes, I think Derek today said you got way too many verses. He's lucky I didn't put all the verses in that I wanted to put in. So Jesus is talking about hypocrites in Matthew chapter 6. And he says they make a big deal of sacrifice without really sacrificing. So they'll make a big deal about how much they're sacrificing for God, but they're not really sacrificing. They're kind of giving out of their abundance. Sacrifice is actually giving something that causes you loss. And so often there's people who make such a big deal about their sacrifice, but it's just because God's blessed you with so much you don't know what to do with it all. In Matthew chapter 6 and verse 5, Jesus said, that they publicly pray loud and long, hoping to be heard of men, but didn't care if God hears. And there's people who, sometimes I listen to them praying, it's like, stop, God heard you already, and I'm falling asleep. And there are all these flowery, pretty prayers, and it's so funny, because some of you people are like, you're like, well, I can never pray publicly, because I can't pray like so-and-so. You don't want to pray like so-and-so, they're a hypocrite. They're praying that way. They don't pray that way in private. It would take too much out of their day. They want you to say, wow, that person knows how to pray. They alert others of their suffering for Jesus, especially when fasting. They mark themselves up. So they're supposed to be fasting as a way to connect with God, but they mark themselves up and make it look like they're just suffering for Jesus. You know, sometimes you just have to give up food. You can tell I don't do it very often. There, is that better? Problem is I can't hold it in very long. But man, am I spiritual. Jesus said they make their outward clothing an indicator of their closeness to God. They would enlarge the phylacteries, and I didn't really study that. I've studied it before, but I was too excited to get to the cool part of this whole sermon that I didn't want to study the boring parts. But literally, the way they dressed made them seem more spiritual. And I thought about that in our day today. And it's almost like the opposite. Back then, they would dress up really fancy to show how spiritual they were. When I was growing up, all the ushers who were supposed to be, in my eyes, spiritual people, because they were letting people in. I don't know why I thought that, but they would always be dressed so nice. And then I remember the time I caught them all smoking outside when I was about 12. Now, I'm not against smoking. I just didn't think that they should be doing that, and at least I didn't catch them drinking. That would have been worse. But yeah, you know, they shushed me back in. But I think we got the opposite today. Almost where Christians dress down and say, "Well, I'm free to dress any way that I want." I think that's just as much hypocrisy. You're just playing on your freedom to be and do whatever you want to do. And I'm not saying God cares about what you wear. I'm just saying hypocrites do. They crave positions of power so they can be praised by men. That's Matthew chapter 23. They constantly want the best seats. All the hypocrites sit up front. And the other hypocrites sit in the back and say amen. I'm teasing. Please stay sitting up front. I like people sitting up front. It's really nice to have once in a while. But hypocrites don't care about the work of God. They care about where they fit in the work of God. They care about the power they have, whether they get to make decisions or not, or whether they get to choose what happens in the things of God instead of just being a servant. And they viewed themselves spiritually superior to the common people. Hypocrites view themselves spiritually superior to the rest of us. They look at you and they're condescending towards you because you're just not spiritual enough yet. Give it enough time and maybe you'll be as awesome as I am. But you're not there yet. I remember what it was like. I didn't stay there long because and I don't know why you're staying there so long. And they're quick to find fault. The hypocrites are quick to find fault. They come into the church. Hypocrites always come into the church, and they're looking for your faults. And you know what? If you watch somebody for 5 minutes and they don't know you're watching them, you're going to find a fault in them. Especially those of you that pick your nose. And you make it easy for hypocrites to judge you because you're going to do something wrong. They're gonna look at you and they're gonna just be quick to find fault. Because that's what hypocrites do. They're trying to make themselves feel better by your wrongness. I think that was a word. Jesus even made a joke about it, calling on their hypocritical judgment by saying, you know what, the problem with you guys is you're always trying to fix everybody else's little sliver and you got this beam in your eye. That's Jesus joking, by the way. It was probably pretty funny when he said it. But hypocrites, they got this beam. It's this beam of judgment. You can't even see to clearly help other people because you're so busy looking at this beam. And I really thought about this beam. I was in the middle of Nevada on the loneliest road in America. And it's a long, boring road where miles and miles and miles and miles and miles of straight stretch. And I was thinking about this beam. And you know what's interesting about this beam? The only thing you can see is the beam. You can't see who's behind it. You can't see what's really going on in their life. You really have no clue, but your judgmental spirit blinds you to the truth of who somebody is and what they really need. Jesus called them hypocrites. I love the story in Luke chapter 18 and verse 11 where the Pharisee is so glad he's not like the others. That he says, thank you, God, for not making me like that person. Because I'm so holy and so righteous. I tithe and I serve and I sacrifice. I'm just so amazing. Thank you for making me not like Andrea Clayton. And Andrea Clayton said, be merciful to me, a God, a sinner. And Jesus says, you know who is justified? It wasn't the hypocrite who thought he was better than everybody else. It was the one who recognized who they were and was so busy looking at themselves, they were just praising God that God would let them pray. And Jesus said the one who was saved was the one who was humbled by his weakness, not exalted by his strengths. See, hypocrites are all about their strengths. It's all about how good they are, how much better they are than you lowly sinners. I just love that. Thank you, God, for not making me like Andrea. I prayed that this week, just so you know. I wanted to see how it worked. Hypocrites are fake, Jesus said. Hypocrites are also fighters. They get angry when their hypocrisy is exposed, seeking to tear down the person who calls them. Jesus was hung on the cross because Jesus called people, the religious leaders, hypocrites. He wasn't hung on the cross because of what he said. He was hung on the cross because he called hypocrites, hypocrites. They can get so angry and so violent that they'll want to kill you. And I thought about that. I thought about how do you show that people are hypocrites or fighters? I'll be able to help you with whether you're a hypocrite or not. Let me just read a passage of scripture. Put on, therefore, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, meaning put up with one another. And if any has a complaint against another, forgive each other. As the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. And you know what amazes me? I can tell who the hypocrites are when they come to me and say, so-and-so hurt me, and I say, great, forgive them. And they like get mad at me for telling them to forgive. Isn't it hypocritical to claim a faith in a Savior who gave his life on a cross to pay for your sins so that your sins would be forgiven so you could have a relationship with God, that you would not forgive everybody who ever wrongs you. See, hypocrites receive the forgiveness of God, but they don't give the forgiveness of God. And I can always tell the hypocrites who don't forgive freely, fully, and finally, because that's how Jesus forgave me. Freely. It's not if I get it right, he forgave me right where I was at. Fully, he forgave me of everything that I've done to him. And finally, he doesn't bring it back up tomorrow. I'm back! I can tell the hypocrites because you're mad now. Because I know somebody hurt you, and I know they hurt you horribly, and I'm sorry for that. But your only path forward as a Christian is to forgive as you've been forgiven. Your only hope for peace is to forgive. You're not mad at me. You're mad at you for being a hypocrite. Jesus said, if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will forgive you. But if you do not forgive their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive yours. Unforgiving people can't be saved. People. That's what he says. Because if I forgive, it's because I've been forgiven. And that makes you mad. Doing good. I'm doing my job. Thank you, God. The fighters, always fighting. And that's just one passage. I could give you multiple things that hypocrites get mad about and try to figure out a way around and try to figure out a way out of. Because you say you believe, but you don't want to obey. Hypocrites are foolish. They claim to see things in others, but they have no discernment. Jesus actually made another joke about this, saying you can discern whether it's going to rain or not by the sky, but you can't discern what is truth in a person's life. Hypocrites can't, they have no real discernment because they're judging a person based upon what they do, not what Jesus has done. Hypocrites lack compassion. Their disdain for those who they regard spiritually inferior is evidence of their lack of compassion. They just don't like sinners. They don't like people who aren't perfect people. Jesus told a story of a man who was upset in Luke chapter 13. And what the man was upset about was Jesus healed a woman on the Sabbath day. And what was funny about that is the Sabbath day is a day of rest, right? But it's a day of rest to celebrate the work of God. It's because we rest, because God rested on his day. And we celebrate, we rest because of work. We got to work all week and now we get to celebrate. Wouldn't it be awesome that Jesus would heal on the Sabbath? But this man got mad. And I thought about that, about the lack of compassion. In the story, Jesus says, you hypocrites take care of your animals on the Sabbath, but you don't care about people. And it's amazing, and I thought about this from a hypocrite standpoint. The story confronts how hypocrites take better care of the things they love than the things he loves. Let me say that one more time so you get that ringing out of your ear. Jesus said, you care more, hypocrites care more about the things they love than the things that he loves. Jesus healed the woman on the Sabbath because he loved the woman. The hypocrite said, how dare you do that on the Sabbath? Oh, yeah, but you would take care of your animals on the Sabbath. Now, Jesus goes on in this subject to give curses to those who are hypocritical. And again, if you're keeping notes, write fast. Because the idea of this, he says, woe is me. And I studied out this idea of woe is me. And woe is me means that God's judgment for hypocrisy is a life of grief. Woe, I'm not woe is me, woe is you. Woe is you. And what he says, it's a life of deep sorrow or trouble or annoyance. Hypocrites will always live this life of trouble or annoyance. They'll always be annoyed by other people. They'll always be annoyed by other things. They'll never be happy with ever anything. And he goes on to this in Luke chapter 11, verse 42. He says, woe unto the Pharisees, for you tithe mint and ruin every herb, neglect justice and the love of God. These you ought to have done without neglecting the others. You know what? Hypocrites will never know real love. Because they're so busy judging people and looking for perfection that they'll never know what real love. You know what real love is? It's the giving of yourself to another. In all of your imperfections, you're just offering yourself to another person. They'll never know real love. They'll never know anything but superficial relationships. Verse 43 says, "Woe unto you Pharisees, for you love the best seats in the synagogues and the greetings in the marketplaces." You like superficial relationships, but you'll never have a real relationship with anybody. Hypocrites will never have, because who wants to have a relationship with a hypocrite? Who wants to have friends who claim to be something that they're not? Please do not raise your hands if I ask this question, but how many of you in your hearts have a friend who's hypocritical towards you? They say they love you, but they're actually using you. Amen. Verse 44, "Woe unto you, for you are like unmarked graves, and people walk over them without knowing it." You know what, hypocrites, they never truly live. They're so busy judging everybody and everything that they never actually really enjoy life. You know, some of the most fun I've ever had is with sinners. Sinners know how to have fun. Hypocrites are just hypercritical of everything. I'm not saying go here on sinners to have fun. I'm just saying. Imperfect people know how to have a good time. They don't have any discernment, but they know how to have a good time. Verse 46, "And he said, woe to you lawyers also, for you load people with burdens hard to bear, and you yourselves do not touch the burdens with one of your fingers." Hypocritical people are a burden, not a blessing. Listen, when a hypocrite walks in the room, you don't go, "Oh, boy, I'm glad they're here. Now they can be fake. Now they can judge me. I love it when people come to church and judge me. This is awesome. I'm glad you're in church this morning judging me. Thank God, this is awesome. You're picking out all of my imperfections. And it's really easy to see. I'm standing in the light." Nobody wants to hang around a hypocrite. Nobody wants a fake friend. Nobody wants a fake preacher. Listen, there's been a lot of fake preachers in my life who stand up here and act one way, and in reality, they're not that way. I am who I am. And that's all that I am. I'm Popeye. Toot, toot. Okay, we're going to get through this sermon because I'm only halfway through right now. We only got one service today, so. Do you know that hypocrites are known as destroyers, not developers? Let me give you this scripture. "Woe to you, for you build the tombs of the prophets whom your fathers killed. Woe to you lawyers, for you have taken," and it goes on to verse 52. "Woe to you lawyers, for you have taken away the key of knowledge. You did not enter in yourselves, you hindered those who are entering." You know what hypocrites do, especially in regards to preachers, is they work really hard at finding the weakness. I had a guy come to church one time, and one of the things he said to me is, "My job is to find your weakness and exploit it. I want you to be a member of our church. I just, come on around." He was actually living in my home when he told me that. Yeah. Didn't say I was a smart man. But there are people. See, their whole desire is if they can tear down the man of God, then they can attack the word of God. See, then they don't have to obey. Hypocrites want to be able to live the way they want to live, and they don't want truth to be told. So their whole job is to tear down the man of God so that they can destroy the word of God. Because if you don't trust the man of God, you're not going to trust the word of God that he's speaking, correct? They destroy. They're not disciples. And hypocrisy plagued Israel throughout her history, as it's plagued the church throughout its history. And I could just keep going on and having fun with all this negativity, but I don't want to. Because Jesus isn't just teaching that hypocrites are real and hypocrites are a problem. He teaches how to not be one. Isn't that what you want? To not be a hypocrite? I mean, do you really want somebody, do you want your husband to say to you, "Oh yeah, you're a hypocrite. You say one thing and you do another"? That's never good for your marriage or leading your husband to Christ if he doesn't know Jesus. You don't want your coworkers to say, "Oh yeah, that's so-and-so. They went to church on Sunday. You sure can't tell on Monday." I don't think anybody in here wants that. I don't think hypocrite is one of those titles that you go after. So let me give you what Jesus says. in Luke chapter 12 to help us understand what it looks like. In fact, there's three non-negotiable obligations to not being a hypocrite. So if you're a believer and you want to be true, these three things apply. A true believer always respects the Father. I'm going to say that one more time. A true believer, not a hypocrite. A true believer always respects God the Father. See, to disrespect God as the Father is to make a mockery of God, and God's not one to be mocked. The word mocked literally means to turn one's nose at or to ignore or to separate from. And we do that when we don't respect who God is. One of my favorite songs that we sing is "You're a Good, Good Father." The problem with that song is it always makes it sound like God, all God is good in the way that we want him to be. Instead, he is a godfather. He is a godfather. He's not just a good father. He's a disciplinarian. He corrects. He challenges. Amen. Nobody wants to think about that. The hypocrites don't want to think about God in that way. But we need to respect who God is. This for several reasons. One of the things that he taught was nothing can be hidden from God. Look at what it says. Nothing is covered, verse 2. Nothing is covered up that will not be revealed, or hidden that will not be made known. Therefore, whatsoever you have said in the dark shall be heard in the light, and whatsoever you have whispered in private rooms shall be proclaimed in the housetop, and whatever you have searched on your website or web browser will be shown. You can't hide nothing from God. And isn't it funny when we do things that are sinful, we think we're actually hiding it from God, like God doesn't see it. Or we don't even care that we're hiding it from God. And God said nothing can be hidden. Hypocrites may be able to deceive for a time, but nobody gets away with it forever. Ecclesiastes 12:14 says, "For God will bring every deed into judgment and every secret thing, whether good or evil." Listen, there is no sin that God doesn't see. And that's why when we sin against God or when we sin in our lives, what we're saying to God is, "I know this is wrong and I know you see it and I don't care." But to respect him is to say, "Okay, I know God sees this. I know God sees my life. I'm going to be careful how I respond to this person. I'm going to be careful what I look at. I'm going to be careful what I do." Why? Because God's watching me. See, the idea is, I think we, as a people, have believed a lie of Satan. And that lie says that we don't need to fear God, we need to fear Satan. And you know what? If you study your Bible, you'll find no place in the scripture where God says to fear Satan. Says to flee him. Never says fear him. Scripture goes on. Jesus says this, "I tell you, my friends, do not fear those who kill the body. After that, they have nothing more they can do. But I'll warn you whom to fear. Fear him who, after he is killed, has authority to cast into hell. Yes, I tell you, fear him." Do you know that Satan doesn't have the power to cast you into hell? He is going to be cast into hell. That is where he's going to live. I know we get this image of the fork and the red tail and, you know, he's jabbing people, getting them into hell. That's not true. That's a lie of Satan. Do you know who the only one who has the power to cast you into hell is? God. God is the one that decides whether or not you've trusted Christ or not. God is the one that opens the path and the way. God is the one that you have to deal with when it comes to your sin. And so we honor God because he has the power not only to save but to separate. God has the power to save you from your sins. So I respect him because of the power in which God has. And the other reason a true believer respects the Father is because God's fully aware. Are not five sparrows sold for 2 pennies and not one of them is forgotten before God? Why, even the hairs in your head are all numbered. Fear not, you are of more value than the sparrows. God knows every hair on your head. Let me help the guys. God knows how many hairs you have on your back. Ladies, God knows how many hairs you have in your mustache. Things you wished he didn't know, but God knows. You know what that means? That just means that God's fully aware of everything about you and me. God is fully aware of what you're going through. God is fully aware of your temptations. God's fully aware of your trials. God's fully aware of your tribulation. There is nothing that escapes him. And if there's nothing that escapes him, he deserves respect. He deserves us to respect who he is. Every transaction that happens on earth, God is aware of. God is not someone to be mocked. He's someone to be respected. Let me give you the second part of this. A true believer respects the Father. They live their lives wanting to honor who God is because of what God does. Give you the second part of a true believer. A true believer honors the Son. A true believer, not a hypocrite. Hypocrites disrespect God. Hypocrites don't honor the Son. But true believers honor the Son. Let me give you the scripture. Luke 12:8. I tell you, everyone who acknowledges me before men, Jesus says, the Son of Man also will acknowledge before the angels of God. But the one who denies me before men will be denied before the angels of God. Literally, to fully respect the Father is to honor the Son. And so how do we honor the Son? We honor the Son in the way that we live. If we live as he lived, we honor the Son. So true believers live as Jesus lived. Let me give you the scripture. Luke 9:23, and he said, if anyone will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whosoever will save his life will lose it, but whosoever loses his life for my sake will save it. Let me just give you an idea of how Jesus lived his life. He lived in self-denial. Nothing about Jesus was ever about Jesus. Are you with me? There was not one thing about Jesus. Jesus didn't go to the cross and say, I'm going to get some glory for this. Jesus didn't put up with the hypocrites saying, these are fun people to hang around. Jesus was constantly living in self-denial. He came, and the scripture says, in the form of a servant and gave himself up on the cross. Why? Because we needed him to do that. It wasn't about him. And true believers live as he lived. They don't live in what's best for them. They live in what's best for those to whom he died for. And so when I run into somebody who is a believer and everything's about them, that tells me you're not honoring the Son. But when I run into somebody who's willing to give everything in their life, everything, it's not about what's best for them. It's about what's best for Jesus. That's honoring the Son. A true believer lives in self-denial because the profit of the world is nothing. You know, on my motorcycle trip, the main reason we went is to visit all of my family, my brothers and sisters. I am the baby of 8, and at 55, that means they're all about to die. And the first question I asked every one of my brothers and sisters is, can I do your obituary? Because I do really good obituaries. My brother and I, we kind of joke through them. But you know, what was cool is to realize my life isn't just about me. So when we visited them, I wanted to see them. I wanted to know how they were doing. I was willing to take that time because I care about my brothers and sisters. And though it wasn't convenient and though it wasn't cheap, it was so valuable to get to know how they're doing and what's going on in their life. Because it wasn't about me. So I know the motorcycle made it a little more about me. But if you've ever ridden a motorcycle 700 miles, you'll realize how difficult it really is. I was suffering for Jesus. There's a perk. There's some perks in there. But the idea is that we live in self-denial. Listen, when somebody wrongs you, Jesus said, Father, forgive them for they know not what they do. What do? We live in self-denial. It's not about what they did to me. It's about what Jesus did for me that I'm going to do for them. When somebody steals from you, it's not about you getting justice. You let God take care of justice. You let God take care of judgment. What you do is forgive. In fact, the scripture teaches in numerous places, just give them more. That's self-denial. to honor the Son, you got to live as He lived. And the second thing, you got to love as He loved. If you're going to honor the Son, you got to love as He loved. Jesus said this in John 13:34, "A new commandment I give you, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You are also to love one another. By this shall all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love towards another." You know what love is? Love, again, is the giving of yourself to one another. And there's two very specific places I think we show love. And one is forgiving each other. And I know that I'm kind of on that today, but I think that's kind of the idea. Hypocrites won't forgive, but Jesus lived His life to forgive us of our sins, right? Everything about Jesus is about forgiveness. In fact, everything about Christianity is about the forgiveness of sins. It is about being forgiven and forgiving other people. So Jesus loved people by forgiving everyone of everything they've ever done. And I think about that. Jesus forgave Judas for betraying Him. Jesus forgave Peter for denying Him. Jesus died on the cross in forgiveness of the sins of mankind. So if you want to honor the Son, you forgive everyone that's ever done anything and does anything to you wrongly. If you're a believer, if you're truly a believer, if you truly have been forgiven, then you should be forgiving, because that's what love does. Wow, you're getting really quiet on me. Now I don't know what to do. Nervous laughter. Chuckle, chuckle. When I run into somebody who claims to be a believer, but they're not a forgiver, what am I going to think? Can't be true. It got to be false. The second thing Jesus did, Jesus loved by giving everything. He shed His blood. He gave His life. He humbled Himself, became obedient unto the death, even the death of the cross. He just literally gave everything. And I think about that as Christians. I'm not saying God's asking you to give everything away. I'm saying that if you're holding on to it just to hold on to it to make you feel safe, you probably need to give it away. Because what's happening on this earth is nothing compared to what's going to happen in eternity. We say, oh yeah, I agree with that. But then we just keep holding on to things. Jesus didn't even want a house, because He said, I got no place to lay my head. If you're going to follow me, you're going to have to find a place to live. So we're all going to move into Nick's house next week. We're going to give away everything, move in with Nick and Joni. Really, we're moving in because Joni's much nicer than Nick. But a true believer, though, and I'm not saying God's asking you to give it all away. I'm saying there are things. You know when you're being selfish and you're being self-centered. Hypocrites are selfish. True believers are sacrificial. It's not about what I have. It's about what He's given me and what I'm supposed to do with it, which is to give. True believers respect the Father. True believers honor the Son. And finally, and we'll be about ready to go home in about an hour and a half. You laugh now. True believers respect the Father. True believers honor the Son. But true believers start that by obeying the Spirit. Let me give you the verse. And everyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man will be forgiven. But the one who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit, rejects, ignores, fights against the Holy Spirit, will not be forgiven. Will not be forgiven. See, no one comes to the Father except through the Son, but no one comes to the Son except through the Spirit. And to reject the leadership of the Spirit in your life is to be unable to honor the Son and to be incapable of respecting the Father. See, without obeying the Spirit, you can't honor the Son and you can't respect the Father. So what does that mean? It is the Spirit of God, Holy Spirit of God, that convinces us of Jesus. John 15:26 says, "But when the Helper comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who proceeds from the Father, He will bear witness about me." So here's what happens. Here's what happens in church. Here's what happens this morning. The Holy Spirit is trying to convince you of your need to honor the Son in respect of the Father. The Holy Spirit is trying to speak to you about that right at this moment. He's trying to convince you of who Jesus really is and that he is worthy of you living your life for. He's worthy of forgiving everyone. He's worthy of giving up everything. He's worthy of honoring. He's worthy of all that. The Holy Spirit this morning should be, if your heart is open, as we sang, here's my heart, Lord. If your heart is open, he's trying to convince you that Jesus is worth giving your life for. See, it's the Holy Spirit that also convicts us of sin. Those of you that are hypocritical in your faith, you're fake, who are mad at me now, you should be mad at the Holy Spirit. He's the one doing the work. I'm just giving the word. Scripture says in John 16:8, and when he comes, speaking of the Holy Spirit, he will convict the world concerning sin and of righteousness and judgment. It is the Holy Spirit's responsibility to convict you. Convicting meaning that you are guilty of some form of sin. So not only is he trying to convince you that Jesus is worthy of giving your life for, he's also trying to convince you to recognize that it is your sin that's keeping you from that. So what he's doing, he's trying to convict you. This morning, the Holy Spirit is trying to tell you, when I was talking about what hypocrites do, he was trying to convict you to say, yes, that's me. I'm convinced it's me. I'll confess. 1 John 1:9 says, if you confess, let me read it. Hang on, it's in the back. 1 John 1:9 says something really cool. Verse 7 says, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. The Holy Spirit this morning is trying to convict you of some sin, and it might be in the form of hypocrisy, because that's the subject of the day. It might be that you've been judgmental toward people that aren't as perfect as you. You should be listening to the Holy Spirit right now if you're a true believer. If you're not a true believer, you can reject the Holy Spirit because he's not in you anyway. Some of you should be under conviction that maybe I'm not being true in my faith life. It's the Holy Spirit that calls us to salvation. Jesus said this in John 6:44, no one can come to me except unless the Father who sent him draws me. And I'll raise them up on the last day, as it is written by the prophets, and they shall all be taught by God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. And the scripture teaches us in John, I think it's John chapter 15 or 16, that the Holy Spirit guides us into all truth. So the job of the Holy Spirit is to guide us into the truth, to help us understand that we need God. He's trying to guide us to God, and in doing so, he's guiding us to Jesus Christ, which gives us access to God. Are you with me this morning? It's the Holy Spirit that's trying to get you on the right path in regards to your faith life. And once you've taken that step of faith, trusting Christ as your Savior, because the Spirit of God has called you to that, it is his job to cleanse you and regenerate you. Look at what it says, Titus 3:3, my favorite verse in the whole Bible. For we ourselves were once foolish, disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures, passing our days with malice and envy, hated by others and hating one another. But when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, because the Holy Spirit pointed him out to you and challenged you in your sin and called you to salvation, he saved us. Not by works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us richly through Christ our Savior. See, what happens is the Holy Spirit points out your need for Jesus. He convinces us that Jesus is necessary for my sins to be forgiven. And that to follow Jesus, I'm going to have to love and forgive and give. And the Holy Spirit then convicts us of our sin that separates us from him, calls us to a way of salvation, And then when we go to that way of salvation, when we accept that way of salvation, he then cleanses us from the sin. He cleanses us from the hypocrisy. He cleanses us from the unforgiveness and the bitterness and the judgmentalism. And you know what he leaves us with? This is my favorite part of this whole sermon today, and we'll be about ready to go home. Romans 5 says this, "And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who was given to us." You know what you receive when you're a true believer? The love of God. Not just in word, indeed. You know you've received the love of God. And you don't need to go searching for love in all the wrong places. You don't need to be searching for love from humanity. I'm not saying that you don't want humans to love you. But you know what? If you have the love of God, who cares? If you have the love of God, who cares? I do believe this. If you have the love of God and you live the love of God, you're going to have the love of others. Wow, you're all... I need 3 more weeks off. I don't know what to do. It is the Holy Spirit that pours God's love into you. And can I just tell you something right now? If you don't feel God's love, it's probably because you don't know God's love. It's probably because you've rejected the Spirit's leading in your life, who's been trying to lead you to God through Jesus. And you're just kind of playing this church game. You're just kind of playing this religious game. Well, I've read my Bible. Well, praise God for you. Well, I go to church every Sunday. Great. What happens on Monday? Well, I'd forgive people, but you don't know what they've done to me. I get that people have done some horrible things to you. But that doesn't excuse our responsibility to forgive people as Jesus forgave us. Freely, fully, finally. See, if you're not feeling loved, it's probably because the Spirit of God doesn't indwell you. Which is why you have to be hypocritical. Which is why you have to judge other people. Because if you had the love of God in you, why would you judge them? Why wouldn't you just love them for who they are? Let God deal with their sin. You deal with their salvation. True believers obey the Spirit of God when he calls them and convicts them and challenges them and tries to chasten them and tries to draw them to God. They obey him. They hear what he says and they surrender their lives to him. That should be happening today. Many of you who have been hypocritical in your faith should be under conviction that you need to change. You need to confess that sin, have it cleansed from you, and then come to God with a new found faith. But some of you aren't going to obey the Spirit. And when you don't obey the Spirit, you won't honor the Son. When you don't honor the Son, you'll disrespect the Father. When you disrespect the Father, you'll become a hypocrite. And I said it earlier, nobody wants to be a hypocrite. You know the worst thing for me? Is that the one thing each one of us needs is the love of God. We need the love of God more than we need the love of our family, more than we need the love of our earthly father, more than we need the love of a wife or a husband. The one thing we need to make this life worthy of living is the love of God. And that's what God's trying to do this morning in you. He's trying to speak to you about how you're obeying the Spirit. He's trying to speak to you about how you're honoring the Son. He's trying to speak to you saying, God sees it all. Respect him. Follow him. See, some of you have strongholds to break today. Some of you don't want to forgive, and some of you don't want to live. Some of you don't want to hear what the Spirit of God says. You want to find a reason why you can continue on being hypocrite. You got a stronghold. Why would you keep living that way? When today God's calling you out to a new life. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away, but all the things are become new. Remember when you first heard about God, how excited you were? And then you became that hypocrite. Why would you go back to that? Step away from the love of God. Let's stand. Can we do that? As Brendan comes to the platform. I don't know what God's saying to you today. I really don't. I know he didn't have me prepare this just because I had nothing else to do in the last few weeks. I also know that I've been fighting, wrestling with God for 3 weeks for you so that you could have the love of God. Do you get that? That's what I want for every one of you, is to be filled with the love of God. But you have to obey the Spirit. You have to honor the Son. You have to respect the Father. Heads bowed and eyes closed. Father, encourage our hearts. Lord, if we have strongholds to break, let us break them today. Let us confess our sins today. Let us repent of not being real believers today. Maybe, Lord God, what we're doing is repenting of becoming a hypocrite. Or maybe we just want to praise you for the Spirit of God this morning, who's trying to draw us closer to you than we've ever been before. Heads bowed and eyes closed. The Lord's touched your heart. You want to make a decision for him this morning. Would you come forward, please? Just come to this altar. Come on. Today's the day. Stop being a hypocrite. Today's the day. Start living for him. Come on. Start living for him. Come on. Holy Spirit's speaking to you. He is convicting you. He's trying to call you onto a relationship with Jesus that you've never had. He's trying to call you deeper than you've ever imagined. Come today. You've been judging people. You've been cold to sinners. You think you're better than everyone else. You need to repent today. Remove that mark of hypocrisy. Let's respect who God is. He's the creator. He's the one that gave us the Savior. He's the one that sent the Spirit. He's the reason we're here this morning. Because he wants you in this place where you no longer have to be fake, where you can be real, your faith can be real. And you can live a life that honors his Son, living just as he lived, letting the world know that you are his disciples because you have love one for another. Come on, the Spirit of God speaking today. Are you listening to him? With heads bowed and eyes closed, you know this one thing is true. When the Holy Spirit speaks to you, one of the first things Satan tries to do is send a little bird to snatch that voice away from you. He's going to try to send something or someone who's going to put something in your ear that's going to say, well, you know, I'm going to make that decision later. I'm going to hear the Spirit of God later. But you know what? He's speaking to you right now about a decision he wants you to make right now. And that little bird is Satan trying to tell you, don't listen. Don't be real. You're okay. Confess your sins. He's faithful and just to forgive you of your sins and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Today's the day. Let's sing.
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord.
Give it up to him today.
Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true.
here's my life.
Here's my life, Lord.
Today's the day.
Here's my life, Lord.
Today's the day to be filled with love. Let the Holy Spirit do that.
Here's my life, Lord.
Let Him pour it out richly on you this afternoon.
Speak what is true.
Here's my heart.
Yes, here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord.
Lift it up.
Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true.
Speak what?
Speak what is true.
Here's how I know you're listening to what God's saying today. I'm going to ask you to do two things this week as a congregation. And the evidence of you not being a hypocrite that you will carry this out. Welcome to New Life. It's time to step it up, right? I want you to forgive somebody truthfully. And I want you to call them or meet with them and tell them, you know what, I know what you've done to me, and I forgive you freely, fully, and finally. You need to forgive somebody. If you're a true believer today, there's somebody in your life you need to forgive this week. Second thing I want you to do, give away something tangible. Love and give. Give away something tangible. Something that you say, I don't want to give this up. But you know you're holding on to it for yourself. Forgive somebody truthfully. Give away something tangible. Can you do that this week? Challenging, it's hard. True believers. Gracious Heavenly Father, I love these people. And I have spent weeks working in my weakness that they might know you in a deeper, better way. Lord God, I want them to be so full of your love. They can't help but obey the Spirit, honor the Son, respect the Father. And that, Father, when people in this community see people from New Life, they step back and see true believers. They step back and they see what it looks like to be a follower of Jesus Christ. That you may encourage people who don't know you by our testimony to come hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. That they might be saved, that they might be filled with the love of God too. Father, I just think about how awesome our story would actually be if everyone in it was filled with God's love. We wouldn't have to worry about racism. We wouldn't have to worry about people being shot in the street. We wouldn't have to be worried about people being abused. And it starts in this room. Here's our heart, Lord. Not only do we want you to speak what is true, I pray that we speak what is true. We love you, Father, and thank you for this congregation. I pray you continue to encourage them. Lord, I pray for Susan. Touch that cancer. It can't survive with your holiness. Reach in. Find the spots. Touch them, Father, that we may have a testimony of a God who's a healing God, who hears our prayers and is mighty to save. We love you, Father. We love Susan and her family. Encourage this congregation to live for you. Father, be with Rooted. They continue to grow in it. They continue to bind together in it. Father, be with our leaders of those groups, our facilitators, Lord God. Keep giving them wisdom and grace and strength that unity can come to this church, Lord God. We love you. Encourage this congregation to live for you. In Jesus we pray, and all God people loudly said,
amen.
God bless, guys. Go home. Have a great day. Thank you for coming. See you next week, 10 o'clock Sunday. Sunday, Sunday, Sunday.